Outside the embassy, supporters of Ayatollah Khomeini clash with opponents of Iran's Islamic Revolution. As the police try to restore order, their colleagues cut off all external phone lines to the embassy to isolate the gunmen. A field telephone is sent in. From now on, they can only communicate with the outside world through a team of police negotiators.
When you think about it, you have a number of hostage takers. They're armed and they have hostages. They're in charge. Are they? They're isolated in a house. They can't communicate with anybody unless they communicate with the police. They can't even get cigarettes without asking for it. Everything they require has to be asked for. And over a period of time, it does have an effect on them. They aren't as in charge as they think they are.
Hello? Hello?
Hello. I want to thank you for the cigarettes.
Salim.
The hostages, too.
Salim, that's my pleasure. We sent 200 tipped and 200 plain. We didn't know what else to do. Was that all right?
Thank you very much.
Okay.
But it was very new. I have never picked up a phone and talked to a man who'd got a gun. I've never dealt with a man who's carried a gun. And there were six of them. And they had a lot of hostages. And you are fully aware of the responsibility that you make a mistake, somebody could die.
The police play Mr. Nice Guy and send in provisions, but in fact they're secretly snatching photographs and collecting fingerprints to build up profiles of the gunmen. But their identities remain a mystery until the police ask the British Embassy in Baghdad to check recent visa applications. They're in luck. Six forms are sent to London with six photographs. The leader of the group calls himself Salim.
These photographs turn up and it was like, these are the baddies. You look at a picture and you don't look at the whole face. You do, but you don't. You look for something that's distinction mark, you know? It's like the old boss man, I always remember him. To me, he looked like a hawk.
In actual fact, I quite respected the leader to begin with. This guy is known as Salim. He was well educated, a young man in his early 20s. He had political ambitions for the province that the grievance represented. And he could speak three languages, as far as I was aware. He did all the negotiating. He was definitely the leader, definitely in charge of everything. The younger guys were very much more aggressive. If you looked at them the wrong way, or you spoke out of turn, they'd threaten to kill you, or throw a hand grenade at you, or punch you in the face, that sort of thing. But I put it down to young man's bravado. And as time went on, the bravado barriers were lowered, and I was able to communicate with them.
Constantly updated as the important things for us, which are people's faces, what people are wearing, what weapons they've got, if they've got any explosives around the building, especially on windows and entry points, what the frame of mind of the terrorists is at the time.
You'd be given so much information and you work on that. You know, you sort of plan to, how can you attack it, which way can you attack it, how are you going to get through that window, how are you get through that door, can we come through the roof, can we come up to the cellar? It's a multi-choice question, you know, and you try and work out the best idea, and then you say, right, we're going to go for that.
There were many officers spent hours and hours looking into the backgrounds of these people for the days or the weeks before the event to try and find out who was controlling them. And from their activities, they had already bought presents to take home to their families. They've been shopping in Harrods and other places, and some of those presents had actually been sent home. They were also, shall we say, wining and dining and enjoying the pleasures of ladies that they paid for.
The police also discover that there's a seventh member of the group. He's the mastermind, a mysterious Iraqi intelligence officer called Sami Mohammed Ali. His orders are to orchestrate an armed siege at the Iranian embassy in the heart of London. He's recruited and trained the gunmen in Baghdad. Once in England, he supplies guns and grenades and assures them that they'll return to Iraq as heroes. He then does a runner to Heathrow and flies out as the embassy is seized, leaving his comrades to their fate.
I don't think those that had organised them had told them the truth. The chances are that they would be holed up there and it would end up as a terrorist situation. Because they really thought they were going home within 24 hours, that we would capitulate, put them on aeroplanes and they'd be back in their own country. But the reality was they weren't going anywhere. And it took a long time for that to begin to dawn on them.
As day three ends, the gunmen realise the only things going to Baghdad are their Harrods purchases. They've been abandoned by their minder Sami and by the Iraqi regime.
Representative of the Metropolitan Police on the inside, and I didn't want to let anybody down. A burden I took on right from the beginning, that's why I took on the responsibility, I think. I was there, after all, to prevent all this happening.
With Mustafa to interpret, the gunmen allow PC Locke to negotiate with the police outside, a responsibility he accepts to lighten his sense of guilt.
Trevor was extremely bothered that, you know, in his view, he'd allowed it to happen. You know, he sort of said, I'm in for a right rollicking when we get out of here. I'm meant to protect this embassy. I said, well, you can't protect it from six armed men, Trevor, for God's sake. You know, I'm sure you did your best, but they were going to come in anyway.
Well, I always used to wear my hat when I went to the window. It was a matter of discipline. I needed this self-discipline to see me through the day. Because I realised who I was. I was the policeman that was there to sort it out. My whole object from the beginning was to sort this out and take it on and get it sorted. And when I mean get it sorted, I meant that everybody would walk out of there safe, including the guys with the guns.
Very precarious.
Next door, the SAS whiles away the hours watching the Embassy World Snooker Championship.
And all of a sudden, the game is alive once more.
We didn't want them to surrender. We wanted them to stay there so we could go in and hear them. It was what we lived for, it was what we trained for, it was what we wanted to do.
You wanted to prove yourselves?
Yeah, we wanted to do our job. We had done all this training year after year in preparation for one of these jobs and never had the opportunity to do it. Here was the opportunity. Of course we wanted to do it. We wanted it to happen. We didn't want the negotiators to be successful. Ultimately, we wanted to go in there and do the job.